Today. worship. Are you ready to worship?
Yes.
Do you feel a little bit lifted even by that hymnal, the old timey hymnal you just sang?
Yes.
And you say, you know what? God so loved the world and He loves me too. If that doesn't lift you up, if that doesn't, I'll just say, does it prod you just a little bit, put a smile on your face? Some of you this morning, most of you this morning, you still come in. You remind me of Quasimodo. Come on now, somebody. Tell me that you know what it means to be transformed, that you know what it means to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You've come in this morning because you want to be renewed. You want to be reminded. You want to be transformed. You want to be remade into His image. This morning, the Word of God is going to speak to you if you're willing to listen. If you're willing to listen. Over the last couple of weeks, I've had a conversation with several people, and some of them in our old fellowship, and one of the questions is, why are the churches today not growing as they should? In many cases, it was a simple answer. I said, have you looked in the mirror lately? Yeah, praise the Lord. I'm not making fun of anybody who's got any kind of any maladies or any infirmities. I'm talking to people who are supposed to be people of light, precious faith, who are supposed to put on the spirit of praise, put on the garment of heaviness, lifting up their voices to heaven. And you're coming. Some don't even come to worship Lord together. Amen. As many want to use that scripture, they forsake the assembling of themselves together. Can I tell you that if you do not assemble together with the people of God, you are not one of His people. Because the people of God have been called to assemble. The people of God have been called to gather together and reason the Word of God. The people of God have been called together to encourage one another, to provide hope and help for one another. Somebody give the Lord a hand clap of praise. And I'm getting all happy up in here, and some of you need that be poked and prodded just a little bit. I'm looking for that. Listen, I'm looking not just for the gas beam, but I'm looking for a lighter, because I'm about to light a fire in this place. Somebody say amen. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Hallelujah.
Save our race.
built up right now. You feel the Spirit of God this morning. You feel His presence this morning. That means something is stirring within you. I just want this word to fan the flames of your faith this morning, to cause you to rise up, to cause you to be able to open up your mouth and say praises to the one who saved you. His name is Jesus, God in Christ, who now is with us by His Spirit. Holy Spirit, thank you for your visitation today. Thank you for your immediate and expedient for work in our lives. We give you praise today.
Amen. And it is still raining. you woke up this morning, was Jesus on your mind? Or was only, I'm going to church, no, what was Jesus on your mind? No, I'm going to church, was Father God on your mind? Oh, I'm going to church, was the Holy Ghost on your mind? Oh, I'm going to church. Why? Because Jesus, the Son, God the Father, the Holy Spirit. Some of us are denying the fact that God is calling us. We get up in the morning. Some of us are now just thank God I woke up today. Amen. Some of us are certainly glad that we can put our 2 feet on the floor and stand on our own 2 feet. Somebody say amen. There are those, though, that they wake up in the morning and they take their first breath that they're aware of and say, I'm sure glad I can take that breath today.
Amen.
And if it's my last breath, I want to praise Him.
Yes.
Now, that's it. That would be a stretch in most of our imaginations. Amen. We wake up in the morning, or I do, and it's become my practice because I have to do something to remind myself whose I am, who I serve. And I say this every morning, Lord, let my soul rise up to meet you.
As the day rises to meet the sun.
And then I have to remind, I'm reminding myself, because He doesn't need to be reminded, because I want to give glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. And once again, I want to remind you today that according to the Word of God,
as it was in the beginning,
ready? All right. Is now, it will be forever. If you believe that, say
amen.
Amen. Amen. Lord, today we just want to thank you for being here. I woke up alive, as some would say.
Yes.
Amen. But you know, I want to be living. Teach us, Lord, to trust in. Come on, read it.
Teach us to trust you, O Lord, and follow your way.
Do not fret yourself because of evildoers. For they shall soon wither like grass.
And like the green grass fade away.
Put your trust in the Lord and do good. Take delight in the Lord.
And you shall give your heart's desire.
Commit your way to the Lord and put your trust in Him.
And He will bring it to pass.
He will make your righteousness as clear as the light.
And your justice as the day.
Say that aloud like you mean it now. Say it again like you mean it.
Teach us to trust in you, O Lord, and follow your way to the end.
All right, now read it all together again. Teach us
to trust in you, O Lord, and follow your way to the end.
You won't be grieved.
Before the King, everybody. Weeks seem like months, especially if you're the one who are waiting for the delivery. Certainly the mother, but you know, even the fathers just get a little bit anxious. Mm-hmm. I'll just say this, so I remember just shortly before ours were born, but certainly, I was a little bit anxious when Ashley was on the way. It got closer and closer, and I have just one memory when they wanted to hand the baby to me in the hospital. And a thought came to mind, I want to do this. And so they put this beautiful little baby girl in my arms. And I said, Debbie, it's a baby. She knew, just in case you know, she's smart like that. And then comes along Britain. And matter of fact, if you would remember her, she is also becoming great with child. And This time around, I don't really recall her being having that morning sickness and that sort of thing like she is now, but she's having a rough go of it, and that's the report that my wife just brought up to me, and she asked that we would pray. You know, it should encourage you this morning. I mean, I'm encouraged this morning. If someone asks you to pray, I want you to keep this in your mind today, because we've got to be very careful, because one of the things that we have to be careful of is that we don't get all caught up in pride. But there's another side of this too, where you would want to be someone others could call on for prayer. I can remember days gone by, and I say that, and I certainly appreciate those who have in the past have prayed for me. And certainly those who are praying right now, today. And because I'm out of practice, I want to just put this here. I did sing a little bit this morning, but I want to just kind of share some of the words of a song with you, and then we're going to pray. Because there are somebody out there needs to identify with what I'm about to say, what we're about to do as we intercede for others. Now, first off, we want to pray for ourselves. Amen?
Yep.
But how many of you are glad when you were sick, when you were down and out, going through a dark time, you appreciated that you knew someone was praying? Listen to this. My soul was sick and dying, bound in sin and shame. Somebody called upon the Lord until sweet redemption came. Somebody helped me up to God when I was feeling down. I'm so glad that somebody prayed so that I can sing it now. Somebody got another prayer through. Somebody touched the Lord. Somebody just touched heaven for another need once more. Somebody prayed until the Spirit came. Somebody called on Jesus' name. Somebody knocked upon heaven's door. Somebody touched the Lord. I just have to offer this one editorial. I suppose it's, and maybe you could say, it's one of my peeves, and I'm going to take my liberty today, being a pastor and I'm a preacher today. Someone says, my thoughts and my prayers are with you. I don't want any of that. I appreciate that you thought about me, but I don't want your prayers with me. Come on, work with me here. I don't want your prayers with me. Now, if you're coming to me for prayer, realize this. If you handed over a note to me, like my wife just did, and she has done it over the past couple of weeks, and somebody has sent her a message, and yeah, that's right, social media was live, and she was paying attention. She saw it pop up. And if you've got a prayer need, guess what? She'll respond to it, amen? And so will we. But don't tell me your thoughts and your prayers are with me. I appreciate the fact that you're thinking of me, but I don't want your prayers to me. I want you to understand, I'm hoping I can change the way you think this morning, because what needs to happen is if you're going to pray for me, you need to be in a position where you can truly touch heaven.
Amen.
You need to be the kind of person, I'm hoping that this is going to encourage somebody this morning. You need to get in a position where you are right with God, right with others, and certainly right with His church, to where your prayers really touch heaven. Somebody just touched heaven for another need once more. Somebody called on Jesus' name. Somebody knocked upon heaven's door. Somebody touched the Lord. You want to touch the Lord for me? By all means, go ahead. Especially on those days when I'm saying, Lord, I'm down here, I'm all by myself. Can't just wait, like Jesus and the disciples in the bow of that boat. can't just, aren't you care that we're going to perish? I don't have anything that I'm aware of right now that I'm that concerned about, but I am still concerned about many things. Amen? But we've got so many things, I don't have time to worry. Maybe that's a good thing, right, Sister Linda? Mm-hmm. I don't have time to worry. I got too many things to deal with. We need to get into a place where when we pray, Our Father, say it with me, church. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Say it.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. Today.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us.
Trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Father God, we take comfort in knowing that, Lord, you have shared through your Son. You have shared in our trials. And Lord, there are trials that we go through. There are things we go through. And even today, Lord, we talk. I made mention, Lord, of these two young women who are expecting children. Lord, they're pregnant. They're great with child. And Lord, there's a whole future that's about to change as they're going through their changes. You know the pain. You know how they feel. And then there are those who are going through other things, maybe that we anticipate doesn't end quite so good, perhaps. But Lord, why is it that we want to go to those dark death places when we need to recognize that though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, you're with me. Lord, you've always been there. You've been touched by everything. You've felt everything. You've experienced everything we do. And through your Son, Jesus, you've proved that you can identify. You know how we feel. Lord, you know the pain. Oh, and God, you know betrayal. And you're familiar with suffering. Lord, I ask today, Lord, for you to strengthen us as your children. I pray today, Lord, for the various names that are on the back of our bulletin and a different prayer list through our fellowship and through our churches, not just here in New Buffalo at the Lighthouse Village, but there are other prayer lists. Lord, today, if we have them, Father, we could spend all day into the night lifting those prayers up, knocking on heaven's door. Today, Lord, we're putting into practice that knocking and that seeking and that asking. Lord, we're asking today, Lord, for you to reveal yourself during some of these difficult times. And we know, Lord, we sing the songs when life is easy when we're on the mountain, but Lord, then things changed because we're down, some are down in valleys. Some are truly knocking on death's door. And Lord, you have promised to give us life. Again, Lord, we thank you that we know that you've been touched with our trials. And thank you, Lord, that this is not the end of it all. But today is a new beginning for us. Yes. Lord, as we look forward, Lord, to the days that are ahead, we're reminded of the trials that were behind. We're reminded of the victories that we went through. And Lord, there is no victory without trials. As it has been said before, and I'm saying today, no pain, there's no gain. While we're here in this world, we are not exempt from trials. And we can't receive that crown without victory. And we can't have the victory without going through the battle. Lord, thank you that you're there in the battle with us. You have not left us, neither have you forsaken us. And everybody who prayed this in Jesus' name said, Amen. 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 Brother, would you get the lights? And Brother Harold, we're going to receive the offering this morning.
Okay.
I mean, you've got a nice, fresh shirt on, so we're going to ask you to come up here. We're going to ask you to pray for the offering. Amen. Come and show yourself a man approved of God. That's tall order, isn't it, brother?
Yes. I pray that I am approved of that.
Amen. Go ahead, brother.
Our precious Father in heaven, you are the Holy One. We worship you. We praise you. We give you thanks for every blessing, Father, that you bestow upon us. And Father, your blessings never run out. Dear Lord, we go through some trials sometimes, but dear Lord, there's always a blessing when that trial ends. And yes. Dear Lord, we just thank you for the blessings. We thank you for those that have made it out today for church. We pray for more to come and fill these pews. And dear Lord, at this time, as we receive an offering, we receive it to offer it to you for the benefit of this ministry and your kingdom. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. So while he's coming around, I'm going to bring us a little bit of review where we've been thus far. We've been speaking over the past couple of months now about what? God's will for you. We've covered a few topics. We kind of walked through 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, back and forth, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 5, chapter 3. We went back and forth and back and forth. And through the one verse, we found out that there was something that we are to do. It's God's will for us, and we're supposed to be an example of this. The Bible says we are to rejoice always. And we're also encouraged that God's will for us is to what? Pray without ceasing, and also to give thanks in everything. Now, I want to hit that one more time. That means you don't thank Him for everything, but you give thanks in everything. If you've got something really terrible going on in your life, I don't know about you, but my mind is kind of twisted to say, Lord, thank you for the sickness that I have today. I sure hope I can get some more tomorrow. I don't think that's it. Here's what I'm saying, because here's a practical application of a verse you hear me quoting quite often. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Lord, I'm laying here, I feel like I'm sick unto death, but I'm sure glad I'm not alone. Thank you that you are with me. Somebody say amen. I'm not making light of these things. I just want to shed the proper light on these things. Does this make sense to you so far? Are the lights on and you're at home? Because I don't want to be talking to an empty house today. Amen? So giving thanks in everything. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You can find something to thank God for. Some of you this morning would admit, you've got some things going on in your life. You say, boy, this is rotten. But thanks be to God. Come on, thanks be to God. I'm still living, I'm still breathing, and I have hope. Listen, I have hope. I'm going to make it through today. I'm probably going to have another meal, perhaps. Am I having another meal today, Sister Linda? Praise the Lord, and I bet it's chicken.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The other thing is His will for us is our sanctification. What does that mean? Now, listen, my mom, my grandmothers, and maybe some aunts, and maybe even a few uncles, says, you know, I need to go take a bath. Well, wait, I need to get cleaned up. No, wait, there's more to it than this. Sanctification is being separated for a purpose. In this case, to being separated for the service of God and His kingdom. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in this vessel, in this earth, right here. Whatever you plan for me in heaven, I want it to be carried out here in this life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And then last week we dealt with something else, because you put this all together and it has something to do with a verb, an action word. And what we learned we're supposed to do last week?
Something good.
Something good. Now some of us, all we want to do is tell me something good.
You want God to tell me that you love me? Yeah. And that's as far as it goes. You just want to know that God loves you, but you're, wait, hold on. If you know that God loves you, it's not just enough to hear that he loves you, but it needs to be reflected that God loves you, that God so loved the world that he sent his son. And listen, not just for you, not just for me, but for all of creation. And that just makes me want to sing. How can I keep from singing your praise? I don't know how you keep from singing his praises. How you keep from gathering together in the fellowship of saints. Well, it just doesn't do for me, because I want somebody to tell me something good. Just so you know, I'm telling you something good this morning. Something that there is no substitution for. It's the Word of God. It's the truth. It's the truth that transforms. It's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by... So maybe you're like me. Not exactly like me, but a lot like me. And you come through and you say, okay, well, I want to do good. And we covered a topic of wait a minute. Is it always right to do good or to do right if it's right in your own sight? I have learned something. I'll just give you an example. If you come to somebody's house and you come to visit, you go to their house, you come to visit, you go in their kitchen, you go in there and you fix up a meal. Now, some of you are saying, hey, bring it on. But for the most part, hey, listen, even my kids and my grandkids ask if they can even get in the refrigerator. Even though I told them, I said, hey, you're free to do so. Go right ahead. Or, wait, there's something in the refrigerator. My mother lives with us. My son's in the refrigerator. I look in there. I don't remember putting this in there. I say, hey, Mom, can I eat this? Now, just so you know, I still have my own teeth. She doesn't say, I'm sure you're capable of it. No, I'm asking for permission.
That's me.
There's a lot. I'll say a weak example, but sometimes you might be doing something that's good. If I came over to your house to fix something, here, I'll give you something. Sister Mickey might appreciate it, but you know what? I think she, for somehow or other, I know folks like this. Recently I had this privilege of stopping by her house. And she fed me. And then she said I could come back and she'd fix some more. Why? I think she likes doing it. It's good for both of us. Amen? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Some who actually work in the church or who maybe do ministry through the kitchen or anything else, they're in there and they're slaving over a hot stove. For the most part, you don't hear too much complaining. For the most part, you hear a complaint if they say, listen, we want you to sit down today. Just so you know, it's pretty entertaining to see someone who's sitting down. My point is that, you know, it's not always good to do what is right in your own sight. But you should do good, somebody say that. The whole point I'm making is sometimes it's hard to discern what is right to do. Sometimes what is good isn't right. Without getting real deep and without getting all cerebral on you, you know, we've got to be careful because sometimes we think we're doing good, but what we're doing is we're enabling. That'll be a topic for a different time, but not for today. I just need you to understand this morning, it would not always am I in a position when someone calls for help where I can go to help them. Where I can be the help for them. I'm one person. And Jesus had this problem when he was here, did he not? He's just one person. He couldn't be where they needed. And maybe that wasn't so bad. Because there comes a time, and I'm sure maybe my mom was glad when I learned how to clean my own, you know, tear my own clothes. And of course, she helps me with that too today. But I clean up after myself. I'm thinking that she was probably glad when I finally got to where I could take care of myself. She didn't have to
you know, mash up my food for me and spoon feed me anymore. I think it was good that I could do good for myself. Amen. But today I want to talk about, as a matter of fact, over the next couple of weeks, we're going to talk about discerning God's will. In other words, I would like for you to consider this over the next couple of weeks. How we can discern the will of God. And if I continue on, it won't happen today, but some of this is going to be in here. But also, how do we find that motivation for doing the will of God? Some of us, that's what we need. We need to find somehow to get stirred up, to be able to get up and do what God wants us to do. And this is key right here, because we also need to make God's will a priority in our life instead of everything else. Well, I had a birthday party to go to, and you know, and I got this, and I got that, and I had a man in church, but I had this, that, and the other thing, you know. Yep. Well, the sun was shining, and I had to go fishing. Lastly, I want you to make a note of this. And maybe this is something, because I'm hoping you consider what I'm about to tell you. In the next couple of weeks, I'm going to deal with finding out what God's permissive will is about. That's going to be deep, isn't it? It's about to get deep up in here. We don't live within God's perfect will, do we? If we lived within God's perfect will, nobody would be dying, nobody would be sick, there'd be no sin. You know, I know that when we get there, well, like the song says, there'll be no graves on the hillsides of glory. There'll be no pain in the streets paved with gold. Some of us were looking forward to that, aren't we? But in the meantime, we're here. And I think while we're here, we need to make the best of it. And so having said that, I want to talk to you today about discerning God's will. Open your Bibles, if you will, to Romans chapter 12. It'll be a couple of verses that are probably very familiar to most of us here this morning. Romans chapter 12. Because once again, we have to decide what the will of God is for us. And we need to know. How do you discern? How do you know it's the will of God? And as you're going there, I'm going to share something over the last probably week or so, maybe months, I don't know, maybe longer. There are days when I really don't know. And it disturbs me because I would like to be like most people. Well, I want to schedule everything just A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, you know, this amount of time for that amount of time for this. And guess what? I can set it up and I can get it done. Life doesn't seem to work like that for me and for most people. Can I get a witness? You have an idea. You have plans. Does that say we should not set calendars? Does that say that we should not set time limits and things? No, we do these things, but here's what I'll tell you. It is something that we do actively. It's not something that's open and shut. Although, I will tell you this, there are things that are going to happen in your life. It's going to open. You can't shut it until it's over. Amen? The job isn't done until it's finished. And there's going to be things in your life, and you have to learn how to prioritize these things, which kind of jumps me ahead. How do you prioritize the will of God for your life if you don't know what His will is for your life? And throughout this next couple of weeks, you're going to see some things. You're going to see some things that everybody's been called to do. Number one, we've all been called to be a witness to Jesus. But that's when it gets interesting, because honestly, not everybody will witness the same. Amen? And you can see the examples of that in the Bible. You can read where Paul says, you know, that although the body is one, it has many parts. Amen? Or how about this? We find out that God gave gifts to, you know, the Lord gave gifts to the church, but not everybody has all the gifts. There were a fivefold ministry. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And there's rarely anyone that can do all those operating all those gifts. So I want you to get to this point here this morning, because we need to get to a place where we can behave like a Christian. You say you are one, then be one in Jesus' name. Would you lift your hand to heaven this morning as I prepare to deliver this message to you? in this section of about being not conformed to this world. Father, in the name of Jesus, even as Paul had wrote that he was beseeching us, Lord, by the mercies of God, Lord, today I present myself. And these are here, those who are agreeing with me right now, we're all presenting ourselves as living sacrifices, setting aside our pride, setting aside our preferences, and less that preferences because we've chosen you over everything else. Lord, today I pray that the anointing of the Holy Spirit will settle in this place. And that God, that there will be an anointing on your manservant who delivers your word, and also on the hearers, that they hear the word. And that we all do the word. Far be it from me, Lord, to speak the word and not do it. Far be it from us to hear the word and not do it. But Lord, let your word go forth and do what it's supposed to do. And let us not stand in the way. So I guess, Lord, I'm praying today, let your manservant do your word no harm. And the church agreeing said,
Amen.
Romans chapter 12. Some of you may have an understanding, most of us do have an understanding of these verses that I'm about to share. But I want to make sure you've got it in the proper context, amen? Paul writing to the church at Rome, he says, I beseech you. Beseeching means, I may not know what that means, you know, he's begging you. I beg you. Therefore, brethren, by the tender mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy, watch this, it's a list of what a living sacrifice looks like. It's holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, as I gave you this introduction, there are many comments that I made, and these details are going to take at least 4 sessions together for me to be able to, I'll say, to deliver what God wants us to understand on these few verses. Many times you don't have to have the whole chapter and verse, but it's good to bracket it all in. But if you don't understand the context of this one little piece, mm-hmm. It's kind of like having a cake. Miss one ingredient?
It is not a cake.
So as we read in our text today, we note that there's a command in here, and it says, do not be conformed to this world. The question I would have to ask to you this morning is, what does the word conformed mean to you? You know, I believe, this is my belief, that there are absolutes. I believe that there is a particular point that the Apostle Paul is trying to make to this group of people at Rome. And I believe as God is speaking to us today the same way. Because it is just a word that we kind of quickly glance over. And many of us, we kind of take it and we kind of use it as a blanket. But we're really not sure what it really means until we've actually applied it to our lives about not being conformed to this world. I mean, how does it relate to your daily living? Well, you know, I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't go with those who do. Is that it? Well, I don't watch those movies either, brother. And I don't look at them magazines and them tablets. But I don't know, I don't do none of that. You know, and I love my neighbor, you know, and I'm not going to kill nobody without cause. I just want to add that in there, because some of us got to be careful. You may have a cause, but it still might not be right to kill that person. Amen? Can I tell you that there are absolutes? And many of us need to understand that you might not be in a position at any given time. Maybe your judgment is not exactly clear. Maybe you don't have all the details. And we like to use that, well, you know, God is judge and he is. But there are some things that we have to take into consideration of who we are as God's people. We need to be very familiar with this term, conformity. Wouldn't it be nice if everybody would act just like you? Oh, no. God forbid. I got some people that know what I'm talking about this morning. Because the idea is that not to just, I don't want you to just understand what Paul is saying, but because this word plays a very important role in our lives, whether you're young or old, we need to understand what conformity means. So that we can properly apply this exhortation, this encouragement, so that we can know why this, why even today I said this is a command. Do not be conformed to this world. So let's look at this concept of conformity. Conformity. I just so you don't have to spell it, I spell it for you.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
Show of hands, somebody who's never seen this. Praise the Lord. A show of hands, somebody who says, I would never look at something like that.
I've seen it, but I've never watched the whole show. I've seen opening.
Now, this is just a light example, but watch this. Listen to what it says. What was the words? As sands in the hourglass, so are the days of our lives. There's some truth, a lot of truth in that, amen? Mm-hmm. Every one of us, just to be clear, my hourglass may have started with more sand than yours did, but along the way, somebody kicked my hourglass over and broke it, so my sand fell out. What does that mean? Well, I have fewer, less time in the world, right? Some of you, the sand's been running out for a lot longer than mine's been running out, which is a distinct possibility. It might be probable, it might be even something that you can say is pretty sure that probably your sand will still run out before mine, but we don't know that for sure. You've not been promised a tomorrow. That's why I think it's very important for us to make today count, make it matter, so we know what it means to not conform any longer to this world. So the idea here is to understand conformity. Here's the definition: to conform to another's pattern. In other words, the desire to be like someone else. Just show me your hand. Has there ever been a time in your life, and maybe more than once, that you thought maybe you'd like to be like somebody else?
Yep. Of course.
Amen. I got most of you being honest this morning. I'd like to be somebody else, maybe be someplace else. I mean, all these things, right? But the idea here is the desire to be like someone else, to conform, to do what they do, to say what they say, maybe even to wear and to look like they look. You know, I mean, I can still remember, I had to have pictures put up, I realized that although I was never going to be Arnold Schwarzenegger, but I thought it might be good to be like him, I did the best that I could to become like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I still can't master the accent. But my point is, there's other things though that, and in a person like that I admire, not just because he was, an all-time bodybuilder champion and all that kind of stuff. If you knew his story, if you knew his life, you would see that there was something that happened in his life. And I don't know his faith walk or anything like that. If I had to judge, I have some things to say, okay, well, this guy needs Jesus. Wait, anybody else not need Jesus in the house of God today? You need Jesus? Show of hands, anybody who needs Jesus. Amen. So the idea here is to accept ideas and the fashions and the way of walking and talking. But the idea of this type of conformity is to do that which is popular. And there's a reason for it. We have motivation behind all this. I'm jumping ahead, but there's a motivation behind why you want to be somebody that you're not. Oh. I want to conform and be somebody I'm not. Or maybe I don't want to be different. I just want to be like everyone else. To accept ideas, to wear, to look the part, to walk the walk and talk like the others do. I can still remember myself, when we first started coming to church, I was looking to do that. But I wanted to change. Because I didn't want to be like what I perceived out in the world. But then I find out when I got in the church, I'm thinking, these people don't even know how to, they don't even know how to live. I mean, they're not really living. I mean, they had this image of somebody who knows the Lord, and they talked like they know the Lord, but they, wait a minute, as I got to know many of them, they, well, I don't know that they know the Lord at all. But that's okay. I mean, I understand that people are at different levels. The thing is, a conformist is somebody who is afraid to be different. We want to belong. We want to be. Now, we feel a need like we want to be like everyone else. We want to be accepted. And there are some people that are actually just the opposite. That's a whole different message. But you've got to understand that we have different types of conformity. We have conformity in our society. Amen? And there is pressure. There is tremendous pressure to conform to the standards of the group. Even adults can feel the need to conform. A lot of young people, young and old alike, clothes, cars, homes, all kinds of things. We want to be like the Joneses or something like that. And there's a pressure to conform. It's often strongest when we're younger. When we get older, we act like we don't care, but we do. But when we're younger, we're impressionable. The young often have this problem with low self-esteem. And it takes so much effort to maintain this image that we want to be like others and we want to be part of the group. They desperately want to be accepted and esteemed by others. Now, let me give you a side note on this. You need to recognize this in other people. There's a distinct possibility they might like to be like you, but as a side note, ask yourself, do I really want someone to be like me? If we go back to the beginning of Romans, and you hear me quote this a lot, although they knew God, they didn't acknowledge him as God. Yeah, I know who God is. I know who Jesus is. Somebody the other day told me I can name the 12 apostles. Really? That's pretty impressive. They knew stories. You see what I'm saying? But just because they knew all this, and it's hard today in the world we live in. This is nothing new. Advertising's been around for a long, long time. Trying to market and sell their products. Trying to impress you with what they've got to offer. Trying to get people to conform to use their products. Years ago, and I know that there's a few, I've watched some of the commercials on TV recently. Take me back to the 60s and 70s. That was entertaining, right? How many of you remember the commercial about the wet head is dead? Trying to get you to use their products rather than putting on, well, actually, it was against brocreme, and apparently it wasn't good for brocreme. Anybody know where I can buy some brocreme? I don't know. Do they even sell it anymore? Because there was a time when the wet look, that greasy look, was pretty spectacular, right? Had your hair treatment. It was handy though, because I can tell you, when it rained, you didn't get your head wet, and when the wind blew, it was right there. Somebody say amen. But the wet hand, don't use water, use our products. How about this? Here's one. It's the real thing. Coke is. As if it was the only drink on the face of the planet. Everything else is just imaginary. I mean, I know people who like the Un-Cola. Amen? They like the Un-Cola. They like, come on, there's nothing good about that. You don't even have any color. Somebody say, oh, it might be politically correct. How about the danger of conforming? What is so dangerous about conforming? Well, first off, conforming can easily lead you to do some things that might not be right for you. And if it's not right for you, what does it make it?
Wrong.
Someone had shared this with me the other day because they were talking about this young man who was out and, you know, his dad had taken him to the races and stuff like that. And he went out and he took his dad's car and he had a friend with him in the car, and they thought they would just do some of the things they'd been watching at the races. So he, in his excitement, he exceeds the speed limit just a lot, and he misses a curve.
Oops.
He was trying to be something he wasn't. professional race car driver. Guess what? He was doing the wrong thing in the wrong place at the wrong time. And not only that, but he was the wrong guy. But he was trying to conform to an image that he'd seen. Amen? You know, brother, you like watching rodeo, right? You think you ought to jump on the back of one of those props? You think you can hang on? No. Call 911 before he even steps on the thing. Somebody arrest the guy before he hurts himself. Here's something else too. I was just the other day. I was with a group of people, and I was with a group of business guys, and they're there, you know. We're pretty much at the end of the day. It's a late lunch, and they're ordering their beer. Do you think I should have had one with them just to be social? No. It's not me. It's not who I am. I don't have to conform to them. Praise the Lord, they know who I am. They're not even going to question anymore. A couple of them felt a little uncomfortable sitting there drinking in front of the pastor. So,
too bad.
I said, you get over it. You see, when others follow suit, the pressure to conform is great. When others follow suit, the pressure to perform is great, and ridicule happens as well. Somebody comes in, they've never, I'm going to bring it to the church. Somebody walks in the church, they've never been to church in their whole life. But what do you mean they've never been to church in their whole life? Well, they've had to be in a church somewhere along their life, because this is a Christian nation, so I'm sure they've been to a church. They come walking in, they've been down to the beach, they come walking in, they've got their sandals, they've got their shorts. In other words, they're scantily clad, and the ridicule begins. I remember that one time this happened, and it happened at a fellowship we were in church in Kalamazoo, and we actually had gone to visit with another church, and one of the youth came, and she came in, and she had kind of like a tank top. I mean, it wasn't like very revealing, but man, these ladies jumped up, and they covered her with blankets. You know what? That girl was never back, never, as far as I know, never seen in any church again. Everything that anybody had ever done, including the Lord, as far as I know, just got covered up, blotted out. I have more stories like that. My point is that sometimes we've got to be very careful. We want someone to conform to our way before they know our way, or have any idea why there's a different way, or that there is a Yahweh who loves them. Amen? See, once you give in, the next time, conforming is easier. How many of you know that to be true? Conformity to the things of this world can do something pretty, this is scary right here. Conformity to the things of this world can what?
Separate
us from God. Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who does the will, what? He who does the will of God, what? Abides forever. Now let me back up, and let me tell you what we hear here. Some of us, we look at this thing, we say, okay, if anybody loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. This is not a contradiction, it's not a conflict. For God so loved the world. Some of us were so narrow-minded, we're so uneducated in what God is trying to say to us, we forget. No, listen, you need to love for your living right now. Not your circumstances, maybe, but your love for your living. How about your love that you are living in Jesus' name? But notice this. If we stop at that verse, we don't read the rest. Look at this. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, these are the things that we are talking about, not loving of the world, not conforming to these things. By giving into the lust of the flesh or immorality, by succumbing to the lust of the eyes, materialism, keeping up with the Joneses maybe, or maybe it's not even that. Maybe you're trying to do something exactly opposite. Or by yielding to the pride of life, being arrogant. I learned something a long time ago, that God will do what he needs to do to humble you. Amen. And just if you think you don't need any more humbling, you're already in trouble. God says, wait, what did I actually say? God says, hold my coffee, watch this. Mm-hmm. just when you think you've had enough. God shows up and says, no, there's more of that kind of following. And by the way, I'm still here. You're not alone. You can do this. I mean, now maybe you can understand why Paul said, do not be conformed to this world. There's a whole list here. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. There are some grave dangers in conforming to someone else's pattern in the world. And how shall we deal with this pressures of conformity? Well, let me give you some tools. The pressure to conform, be a transformist. Transformer. No, wait.
Robots in disguise.
More than meets the eyes. Can I tell you? A transformist, wait a minute, can be seen. Are you hearing me this morning? Be a transformist, not a conformist. A conformist, as we're talking about here, is one who undergoes a superficial and a shallow change. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? A conformist is one who undergoes a superficial and shallow change. And here's the deal. There are those out there who believe in Jesus. There are those out there who say they follow Jesus, but they haven't been transformed. They're trying to conform, but they've not been transformed. How can that be? How can someone not be transformed? It's a good question. Because they're still trying to conform. I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't go with those who do. So apparently, if I hang out with all those other people that fit that qualification, they don't smoke, they don't chew, I can go with them. As long as I go with them, it's safe. Here's what the problem is with being a conformist. First off, you're not going to be a good soldier. As we're admonished in Scripture that we should be a good soldier, amen? A soldier in Christ. We become a cheap imitation. We're not the real deal. And it's difficult to stay that way. Years ago, Tammy Faye, she said, fake it till you make it. There's some wisdom in that. But if you're still faking it today, now someone's going to get all upset, say I'm upsetting them. I don't care if I'm upsetting them. That's you taking up with God. But right now, if that's upsetting you, what I'm saying right now, then you are probably a conformist and not a transformist. Because a transformist is somebody who undergoes real change. It's not just because I can keep the rules. It's not just because I can do this or this way and I don't do it that way. It's not those things. Because it's not by righteous works which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of the regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. It's not just because I can keep the rules. I've been transformed. It involves a renewal of the mind. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And then it continues as we go through life in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. Therefore, do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing. You hurt my feelings. Yeah, well, your outward man may get a little with it. The outward man is perishing. It doesn't feel good when the outward man has to be put to death. There's nothing good. There's nothing that feels good about it. But I promise you that's worth it.
Amen.
It is worth it. Yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Being a transformist addresses the reasons why we conform. Here's the reason we conform. We have this feeling of security. Yet we learn that God loves us. When we learn this, we realize we're special. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God, because I don't deserve it. But by the grace of God, amen. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. We have this feeling of insecurity, but when we come to realize that God loved us, we learn that God loves us and we are special. We have a desire to follow the crowd, but we learn the ultimate end is in following the crowd, and following the world is following the world to its end. Being a transformist marks the difference between Christians who are truly converted. Some of us here this morning, you've got people in your life, and your friends, even your family. You're trying to make them feel good in a position that they are, and they have not. Listen, your loved one has not been fully, they've not been transformed. They think that they're conforming, so that makes it right, but they've not been transformed because they're still wrestling, they're still fighting against the truth. And did you know if you'll know the truth, that truth will set you free?
Praise God.
Amen.
Being a transformist marks the difference between those who are truly converted and those who are shallow imitators of the true disciples. We're called to be a leader, not a follower. And a transformist is a leader. Now be very careful how you take this, because One needs to realize that you need to be a good follower to be a good leader, but what does it mean? Well, let me see. Let's see what a true leader, a transformist, looks like. What is the job requirement? Well, what you see is that the transformist is one who proves to others what is good, acceptable, and that perfect will of God. You're going to offer proof. You're going to give proof. It's going to be seen. So you're not transformers more than meets the eye. No, wait. Everything they get to see. You may not be perfect, but you're being transformed from the inside. And people get to see that working again. A transformer presents his body as a living and holy sacrifice. There it is in verse 1. I mean, and we have the courage to say no to the things that are wrong. And yes to the things that most certainly are right. We're an example that helps others to fight the pressures to conform. We give others the strength to say no. Also, too, we're encouraging others to do what is right. Listen to this, Joshua chapter 24, verse 14. Now, therefore, fear the Lord. Serve him in sincerity and in truth. Although they knew God, they didn't acknowledge him as God in the book of Romans. And here we're learning that we're being encouraged to fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the river of Egypt. Serve the Lord. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, did you know that my house might serve the Lord different than yours? Amen? Did you know that there are different, think about this, there are different callings and different, right, are you hearing me? Different purposes for each and every one of us. That's why I said, be careful about this thing about being a leader, because all the leader is going to do, the transformist, is going to prove what is a good and acceptable will of God for us. I mean, I stand here today, the people that are in this congregation today, there's a couple of you, maybe you should be standing here. And you say, oh, no. Maybe. Or then, or maybe you would say, yeah, that's me. Oh, no. Somebody got it. Joshua chapter 2, listen to this. Then the men pursued them by the road of Jordan, to the forts. And as soon as those who pursued them had gone out, they shut the gate. Sometimes we have to encourage others. A conformist is but a simple follower. There's a lot of people out there in the world that say they know Jesus. Some of you say they follow Jesus. But are they really? The idea, Jesus said, he did say, follow me. But what did he say? I'm going to change you. I'm going to make you fishermen. Wait, we're already fishermen. No, but I'm changing what you're after. You're going to be fishers of men. I'm changing, in a sense, your job description. You're still going to use some of the talents that you had before. You're still going to use some of the principles you've learned. But it's going to be changed. You're going to have a different purpose. You're going to be doing the will of God. Amen? A conformist is but a simple follower, letting others, do his thinking for him, letting others lead him into harm's way. Now everyone experiences the pressure to conform. Maybe you're even in the church today and you're feeling a pressure to conform to the standards and the practices. But no. What did we learn about repentance? What did C.S. Lewis say about repentance? About how we have to unlearn a lot of things that we've learned about the patterns that we live, about the things that we do. And there's some truth to all this. But the idea here is that we need to understand that what I'm talking about is that we have pressure to conform to the standards and the practices of the world. And some of the standards and the practices of the world are trying to creep into the church. Now, is it all bad? How many think a church should be organized? Yeah. You'd be surprised how many people say they don't like that. They don't think there should be organized. I said, you know what? That's nonsense. How many think that God is organized? Yeah. One of the things God did is he spoke into nothings, something that was less than chaos, and everything just kind of, it just kind of fell into place. It seems that way, doesn't it? But to me, that's one of those things that I'm awestruck by. God spoke and everything fell into place so precisely. The earth spinning at this speed, at this distance from the sun, tilting at that angle, and holding it in that position for such a long time, and a little bit this way or that way, and we wouldn't be here. Thank God for his plan. Amen?
Yes.
You see, we have a choice. We can buckle under and be led by those that are destroying our own bodies, our minds, our souls, or we can look to Jesus. We can look to Jesus. Can I get an amen out of that?
Amen.
Because let me tell you something. Jesus was the true non-conformist. We can look to Jesus and allow ourselves to be transformed. What? By the renewing of our minds. If we are to conform, let us conform to the image of Christ. What does he look like? What does he act like? How did he act in any given situation? You know, you can find much of that in the Bible when you read them in the New Testament. You can even find out how God would have us to act and how the people of God acted in the Old Testament and figure out, okay, how does this apply to us today? Can I tell you that the Word of God is timeless? There's no expiration date on it. But I think today is the day. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day when you say, you know what? I'm tired of acting it out. I want to be changed. I want to be transformed. I want to be something that I'm not. I've been going to church years and years and years, months and months. Maybe some of you haven't gone to church that long, but there's still something that you want, you know, needs to change in your life. And you've gone home, and you went down, and you've made your ABC, 1, 2, 3 list of things that need to go, things that need to be added, and sometimes it's difficult. I've got to pray this many times. I've got to do this, and I've got to do that. And we add tradition to it. We add all this stuff to it, and we make it tough to conform. But the easier part is, let's look to Jesus.
Amen.
Romans chapter 9:28-29 says this, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many. It's going to require a true transformation of the inner man. And maybe you're here this morning, or maybe you're listening to this message today, and you're saying, but I've still got stuff in my life. It was shared with me this morning just before the service. that to those who are in Christ, watch this, there is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ. That doesn't mean that you stay doing those things that are condemned by the Word of God, that are judges, not good for the body, not good for the spirit, not good for God, not good for the church, not good at all. No, you don't stay there. You realize, no, I can't do this. I need to do something completely different. But Lord, how can you accept someone like me? See, we're being given an opportunity to demonstrate what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And maybe today you say, Pastor, I still need my list. Give me my bullet points. Give me my indicators. How do I know what the will of God is for me? Wow. To be clear, I can't tell you. I might be able to identify some things. I might be able to point some things out in your life. I can even help direct you in the right direction, but when it comes right down to it, this is where the world does have, most men in the world has, and they've got it right. It's between you and God, but it's not between you and God alone. Some of you understand the reasoning behind this idea of, I'll call it credentialing in any given organization. I can tell you right now, there are some people that can sing better than me. Certainly play, well, I can't play a piano. I know some people probably can perform much better than I do. And it's not just about, quote unquote, having the credentials. It's what the process of preparing to be credentials does to a person. And it's difficult. It's not easy. It sometimes seems very difficult because you're being asked to do some things, or maybe it's telling you not to do other things. It's not telling you to conform. It's telling you to be transformed. And when you're transformed, guess what happens? It's no longer I who lives. Are you with me in this? It's no longer I who lives. It's Him who lives in me. It does matter how people see me. When they see me, what's this? I love that poem. I love that prayer. Christ in the eye of everyone who sees me. Christ in the ear of everyone that hears me. I think probably Jesus can teach and preach better than most anybody. Boy, everybody. Anybody? But today you got me. And your brother and your sister sitting in here today. Some of you have been called, and you have been called to these areas of teaching, and these areas of impressing upon other people, and helping them to come to a knowledge, a saving knowledge, a sustaining knowledge of God and Christ, who now wants to dwell in you, and He wants to work through you. That's where it says in the Word of God to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. This idea of credentialing, it certainly makes you understand that there's something to be afraid of. But it's not the kind of fear that stops you. It's the kind of fear that makes you carry on. I'm jumping ahead of myself. It's a thing that causes you to and motivates you to keep going. There's a song we used to sing in one of the lines that says, I've been defeated way too long. I'm not backing down. I'm not backing down. I'm not backing down. I've been defeated way too long. I'm not backing down. I'm going to fight the fight by the power of God's might. I'm going to take what the devil stole. Jesus came to loose what was bound. You hear what I'm telling you? Jesus came to loose what was bound. So I'm not backing down. I'm not impressing anybody this morning, I can tell. I'm not here to impress you. No. I want to share one thought with you, and then we're going to close. Creator, sustainer, sovereign Lord and King, Messiah. You know, had Jesus wanted to, He could have easily impressed the disciples with His resume. But instead, what did he do? He washed their nasty feet. I said that to say this. You're not here to impress anybody. But you are here to impress on people the idea that there's a way that seems right in our sight, but in the end, not so good. It's no longer I who live. Would you stand with me all over the building? It's no longer I who live. Father, this morning, our desire is to magnify you in the sight of the world. Knowing, Lord, that there are many who will not see, who will not hear. There are many who will hear but will not listen. But this morning, Lord, is our desire to encourage others to be transformed. There are those out there in the world, Lord, we hear, we've heard, it doesn't do it for me, that I'm looking for something else, and Lord, it's a sad thing. There are those that are wondering why certain things aren't happening the way they thought they should, and many times it's because there's a specific ingredient missing from the mix. And Lord, perhaps even many of us who are serving small churches, we wonder the same thing, but we know what that missing ingredient is. We don't possess that missing ingredient. Somebody else does. Perhaps it's going to take us to do what the Word of God says. Imagine that, Lord, right? To go out to the highways and the byways, to learn what it means to compel others to come in. Lord, there are those who believe on you, but they themselves are wondering also why the body, why God's not moving, why the churches aren't growing, and it's because they themselves have denied you of them. I know, Lord, the Word says that we shouldn't think higher of ourselves than we ought to, but Lord, neither should we think of ourselves less. Because, Lord, when we're at the lowest, you have a tendency, God, to lift us up. And the Word of God says that little is much when you're in it. Oh, God, thank you for being in us today. Thank you for being in our corner of the world, for being here where we are today, and Lord, for all the circumstances and situations that we face. And I thank you, Lord, that you don't necessarily put on us anything. Oh, yes, you do. You put on us things we can't handle.
Amen.
But you always tend to provide a means to deliver. Either deliver us from or deliver us to the solution or the situation. Lord, let us be something. Let us be someone that glorifies you in all that we do. Lord, let us consider today how we can discern what your will is for us. To know the will of God and to do that will. We ask this in Jesus' name. Does anybody here need prayer this morning? I know you guys do. Anybody else? Amen. I see a hand.
My cousin's funeral is tonight. I didn't sleep this
morning. Oh, what time?
We're not going to make that. I already sent our message.
Okay. Robin's in the hospital.
She was on the way to the emergency room when I came to church.
Oh, Lord, but we got reason to
pray. I always take her, but she said, "Oh, there."
Father, we lift up all these situations, these names, all the hands that raised today.
Yes, Father.
Lord, we know the names. And Lord, since we're live streaming, I can't really mention all the names that are on our list today. But Lord, I see them here in front of us today. Sometimes, Lord, we just don't see how things are working, or even if they are. But I thank you, Lord, that we are being transformed, we're being renewed, we're being redeemed. Somehow it all works out. Sometimes, Lord, I'm amazed at how you are able to use us. Both corporately and individually. I'm just amazed, God, at how things prove your good and perfect will. Lord, let us do that which is good and acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name. Let's just spend a few moments.
You dance so lovely. While I'm on the way, you sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed.
Shine upon you and bring you peace. peace of these days. Notice I didn't say the last days, in these days. Today and every day after, until the Lord return. And the church all said,
Amen. Amen.